Welcome everyone, I'm Dr. Saurabh Jindal. Today I'm going to speak about sugar, the sweet poison. I've divided this lecture into two parts, part 1 and part 2. Part 1 will basically deal with the sugar epidemic, why sugar is so bad for us, what sugar does, what is actually sugar, and we'll talk about a lot of those parts. Part 2 will deal, which will be a separate video, part 2 will deal with one of the easiest tips. I have 10 tips through which you can easily leave the sugar addiction. Let's dive into the sugar problem. Sugar basically is an extraordinary substance. And you'll be surprised to know there is no physiological requirement for any added sugar. If what sugar does to your body was given or applied to any other food additive, it would have been banned long back. Today I'll prove to you why sugar is so poisonous and what we can do to stay away from it. All of us would know that we evolved from apes. Now, as we kept on evolving, we started becoming humans and then we started becoming hunters and gatherers. Now, humans have a natural liking towards sweets. Where did we get those sweets in the beginning of our evolution? We got them from fruits, from honey, but that also gave us nutrients. Problem is, we moved from collecting food to producing that food, and that is where the real error started. We started making carbs and sugars. We started producing them and we got addicted. And we landed, look at the last image, we landed in almost a reverse evolution now. We are having a pot belly with a cola in the hand. Do you think we are still evolving in the right direction? Think about it. We think smoking is bad. We think alcohol, hard drugs are addictive. And we would want people to stay away from it as much as possible. People know that. Government regulates smoking and alcohol. Government taxes those things. If you go to an airport, you'll find a small cubicle. People who are smoking have to go into a cubicle and smoke there because we believe smoking is bad. So people have a social issue with smokers and alcohol, but look at this. Sugar is the most dangerous drug of our time. Does government regulate sugar? No, it does not. So the most dangerous drug is not regulated. Our children are being exposed all the time to this most dangerous drug, which is sugar. Look at this advertisement of a chocolate commercial. We have grown up having chocolate commercials being bombarded on the television when we are having small children are absorbing this. Look at this, what it says in Hindi. Kuch acha ho jaye, kuch meetha ho jaye. Which translates to something good and something sweet. So they are equating sweetness to something good. And that is a message they are trying to get into young children. And they are growing up with a feeling that sweets are okay. And look at the advertisement. A little bit of milk being put in as if to say milk, because you put milk, this product would be good, but it's obviously not good. So we need to get away from this advertisements, and that's what they're trying to tell us, that this is good, where it is not. Now, how many of us have gone to a movie hall and actually bought popcorn and cola in the break time? And that's because marketers want to link an experience with sugar consumption. So movie experience is not even complete if you're not having popcorn and cola, and that becomes so bad, especially children, to absorb this fact. You would be surprised to know that India is the world's largest consumer of sugar. So we are consuming a huge amount of sugars. We're also one of the biggest producers of sugar in this world. How much are we consuming? 2018 data. We are consuming almost 20 kilos of sugar per person per year. That translates to about 12 teaspoons of sugar per day. This is thrice the recommended amount by World Health Organization. Now, this is why India happens to be sick. India is dying with diseases. It's dying with the epidemic of obesity. Look at this data. National Health Family Survey, which is done by the government, they found that obesity rates have doubled in men and 62% increase in females when we looked at a 10-year comparison. So twice the number of people almost are obese as compared to the earlier times. And why would that be? It has to do with something that we're doing, something that we're eating, which is the sugar. Now look at the health risks with sugar. Look at this. You can see now, look at the red line. This is the body mass index. Now the red zones are the high BMI zones, the yellow, the intermediate, the green, and the less BMI body mass index zones. As you can see, as the body mass index increases, the risk of dying increases to such a big extent. In fact, you have about 12 times the risk of dying with a BMI of more than 30. You can calculate your body mass index from any calculators which are available online. You put your height, put your weight, you get your body mass index. It's not the best indicator of health, but it's at least the simplest indicator of your health. This is for the world. India is even worse. In India now, we believe that the same death rate will come at a lower BMI. In fact, the world guidelines for obesity are BMI more than 30. But in India, the guidelines are different. In India and Asian countries, at a BMI of more than 25, you get the same problems as other people get with BMI of more than 30. So as Indians, we are even more prone to the risks of obesity and metabolic health will be compromised. So we have to be really careful with our own weight. Look at this. Why are we dying with sugars? With sugar, as the sugar intake increases, you have huge rates of diabetes, Alzheimer's, heart disease, strokes, kidney disease, and even some cancers. So the more, it's a linear association. More the sugar, more of these diseases. Can you see these are these diseases you would know? Obviously, all of you know of people around you who have diabetes. Many people in your family itself would have diabetes and heart disease. So many people are paralyzed, kidney diseases. Why is all this happening? That's one of the classical reasons for all of these killer diseases is sugar. So can you realize that if you just lessen your sugar intake, you would lessen everything. These diseases are what we call as non-communicable diseases. See, earlier people used to die with infections. Okay, now the rate of getting disease is much more with these things which are non-communicable chronic diseases, and that's what we really need to be careful about. Let's look at what we mean by sugar. Sugar, when I say sugar, think of it as carbohydrates. We have basically sugar and carbohydrates is the same thing. Think of them as similar words, same words. So when I say sugar, I mean carbohydrates in a lot of sense. Carbohydrates are of basically three types. We have what we call as monosaccharides. Mono means single. This, if you can see, these are single sugar molecules. It has glucose, fructose, galactose. All these are simple sugars with single glucose molecules, single sugar molecules. We call them monosaccharides. Then we have disaccharides. Di means two. So when two of these monosaccharides couple together, we call them disaccharides, as you can see below as well. Two sugar molecules are being linked together. Maltose, sucrose, lactose are examples of disaccharides. And we have polysaccharides. Poly means many. So when many of these monosaccharides couple together, mainly the glucose, when it couples together, you either get starch or glycogen or cellulose. So multiple sugar units combined together. We don't want starch in the diet. We want to reduce the amount of starch. So we have to stay away from this as much as possible. And we have to use this more cellulose. The more cellulose we take, the better it is. Cellulose is taken from plants. It's a product of plants. So it's there in plant foods, not in animal food so much. Cellulose is what most people know as fiber. So the more fiber you take, the lesser is the speed of absorption of food. In fact, your glucose levels in the body will then go up very slowly, which is very good. So it slows down absorption of a lot of sugar molecules. So even if you have a lot of sugar, which is bad for you, but if you have fiber with that, then the absorption of the sugar is lesser, and obviously then the side effects also would be that much lesser. Let's look at this. Monosaccharides, I told you, examples, glucose, fructose, galactose. Glucose is present in honey, for example. Fructose is present in fruits, for example. Galactose is present in milk, for example. These are called the simple sugars. Disaccharide, sucrose. See, I have taken the icon of table sugar. The table sugar is actually sucrose. Lactose and maltose. Now, when you combine glucose and fructose together, then you get sucrose. So it's 50% glucose, 50% fructose, that becomes sucrose, which is the table sugar that we put. Glucose and galactose together becomes lactose. And two molecules of glucose combined becomes maltose. And that's the concept of monosaccharides and disaccharides. Now look at this Coca-Cola. This is my favorite story. I say this all the time. Now you would not know this possibly, but Coca-Cola, who discovered it? And you would have to know that Coca-Cola was basically discovered by a person called as John Pemberton. John Pemberton was a drug addict. So there was a drug addiction that he was combating, and he was addicted to hard drugs, and he wanted something which gives him the kick. So in fact, he formulated something which is ultimately now known as Coca-Cola. And he did that in 1886. So that's what the bottle also always says, Coca-Cola since 1886, because that is the time he discovered this. You know what Coca-Cola, why, what is the derivation of the name Coca-Cola? Coca and cola, right? So the coca part is the cocaine. Okay, so the cocaine gives it the name coca. So from coca leaves that cocaine was put in, and cola is basically cola nut, which gives caffeine. So caffeine and cocaine was put together to have this very stimulating, addictive, euphoric combination, and that is what started selling a lot. But obviously after some time, by 1903, cocaine was not allowed in that particular drink, and then people said, okay, what do we put in this Coca-Cola, which is as addictive as cocaine, which gives the same kick and doesn't affect the sales of the product? And lo and behold, what happened? They kept the caffeine as the same thing. They put the second stimulator, which is sugar. So now you do realize sugar is almost as addictive as cocaine, and we don't even look at sugar like that. So what happens now? These two things were there. You know what they did next? They put in sodium. Almost 50 milligrams of sodium might be there in one can of Coca-Cola. You know why sodium was put in? Now get this now. The moment you put in sodium in anything, we feel thirsty. So you want to take more, right? And that's why you want to take more and more of that Coca-Cola, because sodium gives you thirst. One more smart thing that it did. Caffeine is a diuretic, meaning it will make you urinate. So you will dehydrate a little bit with caffeine. On top of that, you put sodium. Imagine a lethal combination, okay? You're losing fluid out, you're putting sodium in. How much thirst would it stimulate? And that's why it's so common for people to feel thirsty. The more you take it, the more. In fact, people take this to quench thirst, but it's the opposite. It stimulates thirst, and we have to know these smart things that this is done. It is done so that you understand the issues that we have with this particular product. Now, would any of us imagine that we would give kids alcohol, okay, like a kid beer or something? That would not, we'll say, oh, what nonsense, what crap, how can you say that? But do we battle an eyelid when we do this? From my side, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. It is addictive. It is the same thing. The problem is this has got social acceptance, and the kid beer did not really have the acceptance, but it meant the same thing. It doesn't change that, okay? Now, a lot of people say, I'm addicted to milk, I'm addicted to tea. But are they addicted to tea? Not at all. They're addicted to the sugar that they put in the tea and the coffee. And that's why the addiction is not to the milk, not even to the tea leaves, to the coffee leaves. It's the sugar. Try to have it without sugar, you will not feel good with it. And that's the problem that we have. Now that we understand how bad the problem this is, why are we still not able to quit it? Why are we still tied so much to the sugar problem, and we still are not able to quit it in spite of knowing all the facts? Let's understand the biology of why it is so difficult to quit. The reason it is so difficult to quit sugar is because sugar, chocolate, sugar is linked to something in the brain. It's linked to some neural networks in the brain, and we will explore those neural networks so you understand how big a problem this is. Now we have to understand something called as reward centers of the brain. What are reward centers? Look at this brain sample. Look at all the areas which have been shaded brown. This is called the reward centers of the brain. What do you mean by reward centers? Now you can think of reward centers as happiness centers. See, when we watch a good movie, okay, or we come first in a race, or we win an Olympic medal, anything which makes you feel good, okay, there's a surge of happy hormones inside. What's really happening? Something has triggered this brown area. Something has triggered these reward centers, happiness centers, and you feel good with that particular thing. And this is the biology of why we feel good. In fact, now studies are done. In fact, there is a chemical called as dopamine, which is getting released from these areas. Dopamine is the happy hormone. It's a pleasure hormone. Okay. And this is why you feel so good with that particular thing. For example, you take a bit of alcohol. Okay, when we take alcohol, some people, when they take alcohol, this area gets stimulated, nucleus accumbens. This is in the front part of the brain. This nucleus accumbens releases dopamine, and that is why you get dopamine release from this reward center, and you get, oh wow, this feeling of pleasure, temporary pleasure, and that's why alcohol does that. This pleasure is remembered by another area called as hippocampus. Hippocampus has memory for these happy events. So both these together, in addition, there's something called as amygdala, which is also written here. All these three will release happy hormones the moment something good comes and triggers it. What triggers these areas? Let's understand that. Biologically, evolutionarily, these reward centers are good because it helps to propagate life. In fact, the happy hormones are even released during sexual activity, which helps in propagating the species. So in a way, evolutionary, it is good to have this. But we are seeing a lot of mismanagement, a lot of abuse of these reward centers with alcohol. So alcohol does the same thing. It rewards it. It stimulates it so you feel good doing that. So people get addicted to alcohol. People get addicted to smoking. Exercise is a stimulant of the reward centers. And that's why there's so many people who like doing exercise because of endorphin release and dopamine release. Cocaine stimulates it. And guess what? Sugar is also a stimulator of the same reward centers. And you now understand how difficult it is for people to stop the sugar because it's linked to release of dopamine. In fact, sugar does something unique. Any addictor, for example, if you have any addiction to alcohol, you take alcohol on day one, maybe in 30 ml, 40 ml, 50 ml, less amount of alcohol, it would give you the high that you need. But what happens? Gradually over time, you become tolerant. You need to have more and more alcohol to get the same effect. Exactly the same thing with sugar. As sugar keeps on coming in, as dopamine keeps on getting released inside, one day you would need more and more sugar to get give you the same result, and that is called sugar addiction. Like we have alcoholics, we also have sugarholics, meaning somebody who just cannot leave sugar and he needs more and more to get the same result. All of us know of the emotion of hunger. We also know emotion of satiety. Now we'll talk about the emotion of craving. And there's an actual emotion that we will see as well. Now see this video. I want you to focus on this. If you take a sugar containing meal, look at the sugar and the time, you have an increased spike of sugar, massive spike of sugar. Insulin gets released, which will parallel the spike of sugar, and you would get a high with this spike. But then after some time, you also get the low. Look at the low of the sugar. So you dip down quite fast, and this gives you the craving that we have. So see this, you have the high of sugar and also the low of sugar. It's almost a roller coaster ride that you're having with any sugar meal that you have. And that gives you the craving to want to have more. And that is why when you have this increased high of dopamine and endorphin release in your system, you want to crave. After you are craving for something more like that, you want to have something sweet. It is then very difficult to avoid carrots, for example, because you're craving at this time, you're low now. So there was a high and there's a low. During the low time, you don't want carrots. You want this something sweet to come in. And that is why it is so attractive to get these donuts or something sweet. And that is what it is. Now, in fact, there have been so many studies now which have been done on the activation of these reward centers. Let's take an example of broccoli. Now, if you have this broccoli kind of a thing, does anybody crave broccoli? Do you even imagine a sentence, oh, I'm craving carrots. I'm desperate for carrots. I'm desperate for cauliflower. I'm desperate for broccoli. No, we have not even heard those sentences. But do people not say, I'm craving for a cake. I'm craving for ice cream. I'm craving for a chocolate, right? So where is these sentences coming from? Look at this. If you have broccoli, for example, look at the activation of the reward centers. Look at the upper part. Look at this red dot. It's a very small activation. Okay, with food, but not a massive activation. Look below that yellow part. This is the front prefrontal cortex, the front part of the brain, also a part of the reward center. So very small stimulation for them. But look at ice cream, for example. Massive stimulation. Look at the upper part. Massive stimulation of these happy centers, these reward centers. And that's why you want to go more and more towards these things rather than something which is more nutritious. And that's the emotional connect we have with sugar, and that's a craving biology that we have, right? Now look at the normal stimulation of these reward centers. These are stimulated, so you can see the color, they're red and the green. So for example, you're winning a race, you have a lot of these dopamine endorphin release. That's a good thing. That's a healthy way of activating the reward centers. But cocaine does the same thing, and obesity does the same thing, meaning chronic sugar intake also activates almost the same sugar center, same reward centers. So these are PET scan images, and that is why you can understand why it's almost the same thing, which is sugar is doing almost the same thing which cocaine does. So sugar has all the features of addiction. Why do you say it's an addictor? You want it. You feel happy taking it. You feel low not taking it. You have craving, you want more and more of it, and tolerance, meaning you want more and more to get the same effect, almost like alcohol. So you're basically going from liking to wanting. And this is the traditional jump and the walk you have from just taking some sweets in childhood to really want it every time you feel sad. You want to just jump in and have something sweet because it boosts you up mentally for a few minutes. And you know, people want to have more and more of these unhealthy ways of stimulating their reward centers. Now, so we know we have this huge sugar jump when we have something, right? But the problem is insulin gets released after that. And you have a dip and you have a sudden crash. And this crash is the craving that we're talking about. So the craving comes because of the lowness of that thing. It dips down so far below. So it's a high tip and a high trough. So that's how it is, a high crest and a high trough. And that's the problem we have. And that is where the hunger craving would really come in if you have a carbohydrate sugar rich diet. So the more carbohydrates you have, the more hunger you feel, the more cravings you feel. And look at the sugar addiction cycle. You eat sugar, your blood sugar spike rapidly, you have an insulin surge, blood sugar falls rapidly, you crave that thing again. So it's almost a circle, a vicious circle of the sugar addiction. You just can't seem to come out of it. Now, I'll give you an example. Look at the example of maybe a Ferrari engine. If you take a sugar carb rich food, look at the dashboard of this Ferrari engine, 344 kilometers an hour. Does it not feel like a great thing? It is a thrill. You get a rush out of driving so fast, but you're losing fuel so rapidly. You're using that and see what happens. There's a crash. You're losing out on fuel. Fuel is empty. Now your car comes to a stop because you're burning fuel so much. So now this car has to get to a fuel station and refuel itself. Again, you drive at 350 kilometers an hour. You wash off your fuel so easily, you want to go in again. So basically, when you have a sugar carb rich food, it's an inefficient fuel usage. You need to refuel again and again, meaning you need to basically go to the carb station, to the sugar station to refuel, which is your fridge, which is some sugary food, you want some cola, something of that sort. So basically, you just want to take in every few hours. And that's why people say that eat every few hours. But that is unhealthy. And that happened because you only had sugar and carb-rich food. Okay, look at the comparison. If you had fats and proteins more than carbs and sugar, then the rise would be much slower. Can you see? It's a flatter curve. And your insulin also would be much lesser. See, this blue line is insulin. Right? So sugar is less, insulin is less, so less highs and less lows, so obviously less hunger and less cravings. So people who have more fats, healthy fats, people who have proteins will have less hunger. In fact, if you have avocado, for example, coconut oil, you have olive oil, these are called as healthy fats, milk fats, for example, then you have more satiety. In fact, if you have something, then you will not feel hungry for a very long period of time. That is why it's easier to maintain less food if you have a fat and protein rich meal. In fact, this is our version. This is a doctor's version of flattening the curve. See, we have the corona and the COVID epidemic going on. People say flatten the curve. Now, nutritionally, how do I flatten the curve? Have fats and proteins, which is not a big roller coaster, which is a smaller roller coaster. So that's why it's more superior. So we want a car, which is in India, we have the Tata Nano car, and this is more fuel efficient. You can go on for more mileage. You can go on for more kilometers. It gives you more mileage. So basically, low carbs, fats, and protein-rich foods is a car which doesn't need to refuel that much. Less hunger, you can go on for more period of time. So look, all of us are aware of a speedometer like this. Okay, this is on a bike. Now we have this zone, which is the green zone, which is always marked, right? The green zone is the most fuel efficient zone. So if you have fats and proteins, you are basically in the fuel efficient zone. But if you have sugar and carbs, we are way high up. We are in a fuel inefficient zone of burning. So my only request is get away from sugars and carbs, refined carbs, get more into fats and proteins, and you have more metabolic health from there. Now see what happens. Now what we need to understand is, how is sugar so bad for you? Sugar and carbohydrates create something called as insulin resistance, and insulin resistance then gives you many diseases. So we have to understand what is insulin resistance. I've made a small animation on that. I want you to understand this. Let's say you take sugar in the morning when you get up, you have tea, you have sugar, you have coffee in that. or you have refined carbs, you have cereals, you have cornflakes, something other, you have white bread. So carbs and sugar, I told you, synonymous, right? So if you have, if you take that, see what happens. You have a lot of insulin release. Now, why is insulin getting released? Insulin is always released when sugar and carbs come in, because it will lower your carbs and lower your sugar in the body. So for using those glucose and carbohydrates, you need insulin. So insulin has to get released from carbohydrates. Now look at two pathways. Okay, this is a tube, which is a V-shaped tube. This is what is the using of those carbs. This is the storing of the carbs. Two pathways. Either you use those sugar molecules or you store those sugar molecules. Let's look at the using part first. So when you take sugar and carbohydrates, then your cell uses that particular glucose for energy production. So this beaker is the empty cell. It takes that for energy production. So that is why you make ATP, which is energy. And this energy is now filling up in the beaker. But the problem is, I told you, you get hunger and cravings all the time. So every 2 to 3 hours, you keep on having carbohydrates and sugar all the time. So your beaker is filling up quite rapidly and your bigger beaker overflows with energy. Now this beaker doesn't need energy anymore. But the problem is, you are keeping on eating the carbs all the time. It's a carb-rich meal. Most average humans have 6 to 7 meals a day, including snacks. So 3 meals and 3 snacks. And that is enough to give you a lot of carbohydrate load. And your cells are saying, no, enough. I've got my energy. I don't need more. But you're not stopping, right? So it is overflow of energy. So see what happens now. When there's an overflow of energy, now the insulin is not able to put the sugar into the cell. So this pathway is closed. So now the insulin will use the second pathway of fat storage. So this is the storage now. So this sugar, which is carbohydrates, get converted to stored energy, which is fat. And that's where you get obesity. So the classical reason for obesity right now and fat deposition is not the fat in your diet. So fat doesn't make you fat. It's actually the carbohydrates and the sugar in your diet, which, because it cannot go into your cell because that's already full with energy, that's what got converted to fats and stored fats, typically the belly fat, the liver fat, the heart fat, the brain fat. So that is all the fat deposition, and that's the creation of epidemic of obesity. Now see what happens. Now the insulin is taking it to the fat all the time, right? Now the cell says, okay, now I've used up all my energy. Now I'm ready to take in the energy again. But see what happens. Over a period of time, a process develops called as insulin resistance. What do you mean by that? Now the cell, which wants energy, cannot get it because there's a closure now. Even with an empty beaker, now the insulin will still go to the fat pathway. Even though the cells are hungry, so cells are starving for energy but doesn't get it. This is called insulin resistance, meaning the body's become resistant to the main action of insulin, which is to give it to the cell. So it can't give it to the cell, so it has to take it to glucose, to the fat storage part. And this is the genesis of, we say, a lot of food is there in the body, but the cells are still starving. It's almost as if you ordered for food from an online portal. You're waiting inside the house, wanting the food to come in. The food delivery person does come in, but he stops at the gate. He says, I'm waiting with food, please accept it. But the doors of the house are closed. You are starving inside, but the food is just getting rotten outside. There's no way to come in, and that is called insulin resistance. And this is the central genesis of almost all the problems which sugar creates. What do you think insulin resistance creates? Insulin resistance basically creates almost all the diseases that we should be fearing. It creates myocardial infarction, heart attacks. All your blood vessels of the heart, coronary arteries, when they fill up with cholesterol, people think that cholesterol and the fat deposits are because of the fat in your diet. No, that's not true. Insulin resistance creates those cholesterol deposits. And insulin resistance comes from where? Comes from carbohydrates and sugar. So sugar gives you those heart problems, not really the fat. Inflammation of the liver and cirrhosis, there's sort of a lot of liver problems happen. Liver cancers, in fact, happen with insulin resistance, cirrhosis. Elevated triglycerides. A lot of people will get a lipid profile done and their triglycerides are high. That's because of insulin resistance. All of you would know about HDL, which is the good cholesterol. Insulin resistance will lower your HDL. So it lowers the good things, right? It gives you high blood pressure, which is linked many times to so many other problems. For example, hypertension can easily give paralysis and strokes. It gives kidney disease. So by itself, blood pressure links to so many other diseases, and blood pressure strongly linked to insulin resistance. Elevated sugar, diabetes, type 2 diabetes comes directly from insulin resistance. In fact, one of the best ways to reduce the chances of getting type 2 diabetes is reduce insulin resistance. And how do you do that? By reducing your carbohydrates and sugar in your meals. In fact, one of the medicines that is given for sugar is metformin. And you know how metformin works? It reduces insulin resistance. So if you have medicines doing that same thing, why not do that biologically and physiologically and naturally by reducing your carbohydrate and sugar diets and going more towards fats and proteins? Increase of intra-abdominal fat. I told you the belly fat. The belly fat is so many people going around with elevated waistlines, right? And that is basically a very bad problem, because fat deposit in the abdomen is a marker of sickness. It's a marker of fatty liver. It's a marker of fat in the body, right? So if you reduce that, a lot of problems will reduce. Alzheimer's disease, Alzheimer's dementia, it's such a big problem now. A lot of issues with brain health. Now that can just get addressed with insulin. In fact, I mean, some cancers also get linked to obesity and insulin resistance. Fatty liver, one of the classical problems of liver now is fatty liver. Now people used to think that alcohol is the biggest problem for liver, but no, there's something called as non-alcoholic liver disease. So fats are as bad as alcohol for the liver. And now we are having a lot of sugar in the meal that gets converted to fat in the liver, and that fatty liver by itself can create liver cirrhosis and liver cancers. Blood clotting risks, so your strokes come from there. Polycystic ovary disease, such a big problem in females, leading to infertility and abnormal menstrual cycles, gets linked to insulin resistance. Sleep apnea, you can't sleep well. So can you see the number of diseases which just links to one central pathology? Insulin resistance, and that just comes from carbohydrates. Now once you understand this, can you see this? I took this from the Cancer Research UK. This is basically the chart on the number of cancers that get linked to obesity. Okay, numerable cancers from here. So that basically means obesity control and obesity reduction becomes such an important method to reduce cancer risk. Now what most people think that fat loss comes basically from this orange zone. If they want to lose weight, they think, okay, let's do more cardio exercises. Let's run a lot. So this orange is what people think is the maximum way in which you can lose weight. And people think that yellow bar is weight training and strength training in the gym. And the green part is nourishment and nutrition. They think nourishment, okay, we'll have a change of diet and we'll lose weight. No. Nutritional components is the major part of fat loss. If you can control your weight and you want to increase your fat loss, it's best to look at the nutritional element, not really the exercise so much. So basically change your diet and change what? Change your sugar, reduce your sugars, eliminate them if possible, reduce your refined carbohydrates, and then we have all the benefits of fat loss just from that, not exercise. Okay. Now, if there's a study which wants you to choose between low carbohydrates and low fat for your weight loss, which side would you tilt? Common knowledge in the community says have low fat. Okay. Have less butter, less ghee, less coconut oil. They think that is what they need to do to change their diet, but that's incorrect. Low carbohydrate is the much more superior way to reduce the weight that you have. In fact, there's a study I saw, okay, by Dr. Paul Misson, who studied so many studies which happened, so many randomized controlled trials from 2003 to 2018, about 15 years. He studied and gave us this graph on the comparison between low carbohydrate, which is basically the blue spikes, and the red ones, which is the low fat. So if you choose between them, you can see almost in all the studies, 31 studies to be precise, almost all the studies uniformly showed that low carbohydrate has more weight loss than a diet which is low fat. So all the blue bars are so much higher. So if you want to choose one, choose low carbohydrate to reduce your weight. Now that we understand the carbohydrates are bad, are all carbohydrates bad? Not really. Look at this. Let's compare rolled oats versus cornflakes. You would find that one carbohydrate is better, one is not so good. So what tilts the balance? Oats are beneficial, cornflakes are harmful. Both are carbohydrates. So how do you define, how do you judge this, which is good carbohydrate, which is a bad carbohydrate? Now, oats are low glycemic index, whereas cornflakes are high glycemic index. So glycemic index is the way you find out what is good versus what is bad. Overall, you have to reduce all carbohydrates, but most you want to reduce the high glycemic index carbohydrates. What is glycemic index? Glycemic index basically indicates the extent to which your blood sugars and insulin gets released after food. So if you have something, how much sugar is coming into your system and how much insulin gets released gives you everything, right? Because if insulin gets released, you get insulin resistance, right? So more glycemic index means more insulin resistance, and more fat deposition in your liver, in your heart, everything. So see this, high glycemic index, HGI foods, more insulin secretion, more fat storage, more obesity. Low glycemic index foods, less insulin, less fat storage. So the attempt should be to have fats and proteins which have very less insulin secretion. And if you want to have some carbohydrates, have low glycemic index, which again doesn't spike up your insulin so much. High glycemic index is labeled as something more than 70. So you can check that online. If you see white rice, for example, okay, or something else you want to eat, just check the glycemic index online. If it gives you more than 70, it's very high glycemic index. Medium glycemic index, something like brown rice, will have 55 to 69, and a low GI like oats or something like rolled oat or steel cut oats will have a low GI of less than 55. So this is how the continuum would be, and it also is how the health parameters come in on these particular GI indices. There's also something of glycemic load that we would want you to know about. Now, glycemic index is not the only thing you need to know, glycemic load as well. Glycemic load takes amount of food into consideration, which is the portion size. I'll explain that in the next slide as well. It's a better indicator of blood sugar rise as compared to glycemic index. And that is why it's a better indicator of your food choices as compared to glycemic index. What do you mean by glycemic load? Take this example. Now, glycemic load, if it's more than 20, it's high. 11 to 19, it's medium glycemic load, and low glycemic load is less than 10. Let's understand glycemic load a little bit from this example I'm going to give you. Let's take an example of watermelon, a small slice, and white rice. Now, traditionally, you would say, okay, white rice would have a high glycemic index and watermelon has a low glycemic index. So I want to have fruits. I don't want to have too much of rice. And then you check the glycemic index. Glycemic index of watermelon is 76. Whereas glycemic index of white rice is 73, you'd say, oh, you'd be shocked. And you say, oh, watermelon is inferior to white rice. You say, okay, let's have white rice, let's not have watermelon. That's not the smart way of doing it, because you need to look at glycemic load. Glycemic load of watermelon is only 4, because a lot of watermelon is actually water, right? So the amount of sugar, amount of carbon you get in a small slice is not much. But glycemic load of white rice is 33, means more packed, more dense carbohydrates, more packed together. So see this, glycemic index load of 4 for watermelon and load of 33 for white rice. That means you need to have 8 times, you have to have 8 slices of watermelon, which would then equal the glycemic load of white rice. So this is called the portion size concept. So if you want to have high GI things, it's important to reduce the amount that you want to have, because the glycemic load would reduce. You can have watermelons, but not too much. Maybe a slice here and there would be fine, because we also need to look at something called as fructose, okay, which again becomes an important point to consider in fruits, because fructose is some, in a way, many times worse than glucose, okay? Because fructose, when you take in, which is basically the fruit sugar, many of these fructose basically directly goes into liver, because it cannot be metabolized easily. It directly goes, it is not used for energy production like how the glucose was, as the example I showed you. Fructose might just go into the liver and directly give fatty liver and other metabolic problems. So that's why a lot of times we would not advise people to have a lot of sweet fruits as well, because that would again compromise on the fructose part of it. But this is the concept of glycemic load that we have. And with this, we understood all the sugar issues that we have, how sugar gets metabolized, what sugar does to you, and what metabolic problems does it create. This would be the end of part 1. Now, this is Dr. Saurabh Jindal signing off. This is my way to change the world one kilo at a time. This is the end of part one. After this, I would encourage you to see part two, which is going to be loaded as well. Part two is, now that we understand the issues around sugar, part two will be really the action part. Part two will be how we can basically go ahead and stop this sugar addiction. And this will then help you come away from the sugar craving that most of us have and prevent all these huge diseases that we have enumerated here. Thank you for your time.